Good evening. I want to welcome you all to our Harlaxton presentations. These are our students from our study abroad program, and we visited England this summer from June 11th through the 22nd, and they want to share some of their experiences with you, so I hope you enjoy the evening. We will take about probably 10 to 15 minutes for each presentation. So does anybody have any questions before we begin? Okay, thank you.
Hi, my name is James. I wanted to say something before I got my presentation started. This is my second time going to the study abroad program. This is my second time going to England, and I really enjoyed it. I enjoyed the group of people that went with me this time compared to the ones that went with me last time. I get asked a lot whether I like this trip or last trip, and I really can't say. I mean, both groups were really good. Last group was more females than males, so it was all right. And then this group had some interesting people, some good people, and got to make some more friends, and hopefully things will get better. And I'd love to make my way back. And I told Sandy this last year, my first trip out there, I really would love to open up a Mexican restaurant in downtown London and bring them a little piece of Mexican cuisine. So my presentation is about beer. So I'm doing a little history of beer, and then I'm gonna talk about the two breweries that I'm comparing. All right, I'm gonna start off with the history. Beer is probably the oldest beverage known to man. It is about 6,000 years old. And some scientists argue whether it was bread or beer that convinced the nomadic tribes to stop moving and settle and become farmers and agricultures. So, beer goes as far back as ancient Sumeria. There's prayers and hymns, one of them being the Hymn of Ninkasi. It serves as a prayer and pretty much a way of remembering how to make the beer, since most of the people at that time couldn't read. We go to Babylon, and there's traces and records of beer being produced in Babylon, and they produced about 20 different styles of beer. The position of brewer was held as a high position. They regarded it as a pretty good job. Women brewed the beers and the men drank it, basically. And then the first major event to kind of pretty much push beer to the way it is right now is the purity law. It was in 1516 when the Duke of Bavaria adopted the purity law, which is probably the oldest food regulation still around. It pretty much said that beer can only be made with four ingredients, and that is water, hops, malted barley, and malted wheat. It wasn't until the 19th century that yeast was added. Some of the moments in American history were related to beer.
Away from it, not on their drive, because they run the screen.
During our voyage to America, people believed that the settlers landed in Plymouth because they ran out of beer. Everyone was given a ration. They, men, women, and children were given a gallon of beer a day to drink until they ran out, and eventually they landed in Massachusetts. A lot of our forefathers, including Benjamin Franklin, Samuel Adams, and George Washington, were brewers. A couple of them decided they didn't want to bring the recipe. Samuel Adams did bring one. He brought one that was passed from his father as an old Bavarian beer, but he decided that he would rather much help the country gain its independence than brew the beer. So we fast forward into the new generation. Jim Cook, in 1984, decided that he was going to follow in his father's footsteps and become a brewer. He had a few degrees in business. He had a master's degree, and he decided instead of going into a business type thing that he wanted to open up a brewery. So he adopted the recipe that was made by his grandfather and turned it into the Samuel Adams Lager. In 1985, the beer was introduced at the reenactment of the first battle of the Revolutionary War. And 3 months later, it won the award for the best beer in the nation. Now, Sam Adams beer is known for a lot of things. The main beer is the Sam Adams Lager and the Sam Adams Light. They produce a variety of seasonal beers, such as the Summer Ale, Oktoberfest, the Winter Lager, and the Noble Pils. Now we go to Castle Rock. Castle Rock Brewery was more of a pub. They opened up in 1977, and it was more of a brewery slash pub. It produces 6 regular beers, and one of them, the Harvest Pale, one of them, the Supreme Champion Beer of Britain, and that was in 2010. In 2001, Castle Rock started something with the Wildlife Preserve in England. They started a natural selection beer. And once a month, they produce a beer representing a flower or an animal that's endangered in that country. The money that they make from that goes to charity. They also produced the Royal Beer. They produced 70,000 bottles of this brew called Kiss Me Kate. 100 were hand bottled and signed by the man that created the beer, the head brewer. And now we go to the similarities. Thing I noticed the most about both these breweries is that they're not sold in other countries. Sam Adams is sold in the United States. Castle Rock is sold in the UK. They both go as far as producing the best quality beer with the best ingredients. And both of the owners were sons of brewers. So it kind of ran in family. Now the differences. Sam Adams beer produces more beer. They have 3 plants, and it can be bought at a liquor store, grocery store, restaurant, wherever you go. You see Sam Adams. They use an old Bavarian recipe, an old German recipe, And then Castle Rock, theirs is more of an old English recipe. They don't produce as much beer because they only have one plant. And they only sell theirs in pubs.
Big knob at the
The cause of and solution to all of life's problems.
Thank you.
If
enter, it'll work, right?
Spacebar.
Spacebar. All right. I really don't think I'm going to need this.
You should.
We can't hear back here.
Del, can you hear me?
Oh, we can.
Hi.
You wanna,
hi.
The little switch on the bottom.
Push the button?
Yep. It should be a slide button.
Got it. Got it. Push it and hold it.
No. Just
push it. I am not technologically savvy at all. Hello? No. Sorry. So, yeah. Okay. Whew. Okay.
Hi.
Ooh.
My name's Teresa McKinley, and this was my first time traveling abroad with Ivy Tech. I graduated May 6th, left June 11th with this wonderful group of students, and came back and had a phone call from Drew Hayes, Workforce Economic Development, offering me a job. So I now work here.
Thank you, thank you, thank you.
Okay, so anyway, my comparing and contrasting is on language, England versus the United States. Now, if you went with us, you can't answer this question. Everyone else, I'm posing a question to you. Who here has ever been to Holiday World? Raise your hand. That's what I expected, probably most of you. Beverly, how did you find it? Yes.
A map?
See, she found it using a map, which is probably an answer that most of us would have given. But whenever the English say, how did you find it, what they're really asking you is, how did you like it?
That's what I thought you meant.
Katina, Natalie, and I had a funny situation happen while we were there where we were in the marketplace with their, there was an outdoor market going on while we were there. Long story short, fine young gentleman was taking surveys from the locals. Of course, us not being local, we couldn't participate, but he was very intrigued with the fact that we were from America, so he forgot what he was there to do in the first place and started talking to us about what we had done and what we were gonna do. And he asked us, when we told him about a certain spot we had already been to, he said, how did you find it? Well, you know, we were proceeding to say, well, we have a van driver that takes us there. And I could tell that that's not what he was asking by his expression. And I said, I think he means, how did we like it, or something like that. He's like, yes, yes, how did you like it? So anyway, that's one difference. I'm gonna be doing the comparing and contrasting as I go through the slides. They say rubbish, we say trash. This is an authentic sign that one of my classmates took. I am not sure where this picture was taken at, but I eat 40 tons, you can see how they spell tons as well, of rubbish a year. They have tea rooms, we have coffee houses. Now that's not a language discrepancy, but it's just some of my pictures in here are differences closely related to language. In this case, tea rooms versus coffee houses. And these are genuine pictures that we took while we were over there. And there's a picture of another tea room. And I don't know if the lighting is not good enough, but you can read it along the side. The steep hill, tea rooms and cafe. Sandy can tell you about the steep hill. Okay. Now, there's a sign we took, if you drop your cigarette, it's 75 pounds a throw. No ifs, no buts, just bin it. So just bin it is compared to ours, just throw it away. And seriously, I was watching some people smoking there, and they would stand there and smoke. They would put it out, but they'd pick that butt up and walk it over to a trash can and throw it away because they didn't want to pay 75 pounds. And you'll find out what 75 pounds is here in a second. cafe truck or coffee truck. This young man right here with the striped shirt on, his name is Ben. Now, one of my biggest, this is a little side note. One of my goals while I was over there was to find Welsh people, and you know, because my ancestry is Wales. So all the time I was there, how close to Wales are we, blah, blah, blah. Anyway, come to find out, just in casual chit chat, I was with Natalie and Tina and Mary a lot of times, so they were doing all the talking. I was just standing there. Anyway, this young man here in the striped shirt, his name is Ben, but get this. My maiden name's Jones. That's Ben Jones from Wales. I was so pleased. I was just like, oh, my long-lost cousin. Anyway, Natalie took a picture of us together, and it's... Okay. Now, can you see the little red signs with the white dashes through the middle? Yes? Can you see it? No? Well, I don't have a pointer. It's in the middle of the screen there. There's one on the left and one on the right. Those are do not enter signs. So again, a difference in their do not enter signs. Of course, we know what ours looks like. It's a circle with a line, right? Something like that. Maybe it says do not enter, to be honest with you. I don't know. Okay, another sign. Parking on the foot, we'll need to try to talk British while we read these signs. Parking on the footpath is strictly prohibited. Footpath compared to sidewalk. This is my favorite one. Now, even though it says female toilets on the bottom, there's three certificates above it is because this particular loo had won the award for the outstanding loo for 2009, 2010, 2011, and it was really nice. It was clean. It was really clean. So anyway, I put skip, skip, skip to the loo because the loo means a toilet. Okay. And here's another one. Humps for 1/2 mile. Speed bumps or speed humps? So there's another example of the differences. And this is, again, one of my favorites. In the bottom of this ice cream truck, it says, mind that child. Which means watch your child, watch your children. And we all see that on the back of ice cream trucks or anything that will be stopping for children. I don't think it says on the school buses, but anyway, typical ice cream truck, English ice cream truck, mind that child. Not only that, but please mind the step. Can you see that right there? That's their sign. And we would say, please watch your step. So the word mind is in exchange for our word watch. And here's another one of my favorite. Nappy instead of diaper. So this was on the door of one of the ladies' rooms. The doors nearby. And it's specifically labeled disabled and nappy changing. So that's where the mummies would take their babies and change their nappy. It's fun talking English. this was another one of our favorites. We found the Dollar General. And yet it's called Poundland, because a pound is equivalent to a dollar. So they have a Dollar General, check it out. Everything's for 1 pound. So. Anyway, got a lot of souvenirs there. And there we go, a pub in England, a bar in America. This is the Bat and Fiddle, which is a Castle Rock Tap Guest Cask Ales Good Pub Food. Public Meeting House, no, public, I forget what the pub's. What does PUB stand for? Public, right, short for public house. Okay, so anyway, that's the, just comparing and contrasting in that situation. Their refectory is our dining room. And you can see that's the second word listed on that list of places. They say to let, we say to rent. Now you will have to really look closely. If the lights were a little dimmer, it's up there, how do I describe, bottom deep. And it's a white word that says to let on a blue background. So anyway, to let means for rent. And there underground is our subway. I threw this in because of the word scone. It's basically a biscuit, because I was thinking, you know, something sweet, but it didn't have much sweetness to it at all. And I've heard that word pronounced scone and scones. Scone and scone. And so I asked somebody while I was there, I'm very inquisitive, if I didn't have a question, I'm just gonna ask. And I said, what is the correct pronunciation? And they said that the how do they refer to them? The commoners say scone, and the upper class, I guess, say scones. So anyway, that's why I threw that picture in, because it's very common over there. Scone served with clotted cream and tea. And I wanted to show you this picture because they have temporary hiring agencies over there too. There's a sign right there, the little one of those portable street signs that we see around here in the States, but it talks about temporary work and the agency that's hiring. Then of course I had to throw in something familiar. They had a Krispy Kreme over there, I couldn't believe it. They had Starbucks, McDonald's, Pizza Hut, and Krispy Kreme, so I threw that in there just because of a similarity. This is the vending machine that was inside Harlaxton. Snacks are similar, but yet the packaging is totally different. They have double-decker buses. We do not, I don't think, for the most part. If there are, no. There really isn't. They have double-decker buses. We don't. That's what their mailbox looks like. And you know that ours do not look like that. Check out the telephone booths. Aren't those cute? Oh, that's my friend Katina posing up there. So anyway, we don't even have telephone booths, my husband pointed out to me, anymore. And this is the sign that we took called there's a store called the Pot Shop. So I put, I wonder what they sell in there. No, none of us went up to find out, but it was cute. And in here, heifers. So, just a little funny signs that we took. The end.
Thank you. Any questions, comments, or concerns?
What's clotted cheese?
Clotted cream.
Mary, what is clotted cream?
Clotted cream is a cream that is mainly produced in Devonshire, down on the coast. It is like three creams. We always have two. There's three creams. There's a real heavy, heavy cream, which is your clotted cream.
Oh, okay.
And sometimes they bake it to even make it more thick. And then some of them will flavor it, but it's just mostly cream. Instead of whipped cream, it's cream.
Okay.
And you put it on your scone with your jelly.
I can't figure out what the word clotted means.
Uh-huh. It does sound kind of gross, doesn't it?
Yeah.
Like lumpy.
It's like
curdles,
clotted. It's kind of
like
butter.
Yeah.
It's
kind of
like
a strawberry.
It's like a
strawberry.
It's
like
a
Oh no.
What did it say? Slow dead
we
children?
We saw one sign. Dead children. Is that when we were going to Beaver Castle?
It's,
you should have one that said blind the deaf.
Oh, we did. Yeah, that was on every time. But it said dead slow children. That's what it said. And I think that meant slow down because children weren't present. I don't think it meant they were dead slow children.
My name is Jeremy Fraser, and this is also my first trip to England as well. And I just want to say I had a wonderful time with you guys, which was a very good learning experience, as I knew it would be. My presentation is on British and U.S. politics and the differences between the two. A lot of people think that being as close as we were back in the 1700s, that they don't like to recognize that anymore, that we would have a lot of similarities, but we don't. I'll just explain some. The flags, as you see, at political events, as everybody knows here in Washington, D.C., the American flag at presidential State of the Union addresses, or any national holiday, is predominant and all over the place. And politicians will make reference to the flag in their speeches and God bless America and everything. Great Britain, though, the Union Jack is not predominant anywhere at political events, and it's hardly even recognized. Nobody sings to it over there. Nobody makes reference to it. Also, the American politicians using phrases like God bless America, the British never use God in any of their speeches and think it's rubbish to even believe that God would put them any over number one over anybody else in the world. Great Britain, run by the monarchy, or so I believe before I went, and Queen Elizabeth II ran the whole show, but politically she doesn't run much of anything. We learned over there that the monarchy's really nothing anymore. It's just there for money, it's there for tourism, but politically, they'll bring her in, she'll read a pre-written letter, she'll read what they've written for her, and she will go back off to Windsor Castle or Buckingham Palace, and that's about all she does. So King William will do the same eventually. Prime Minister is David Cameron. That is the man that runs the political show in England. As you can see, the Prime Minister of England can be Prime Minister until the day that he dies. As long as he keeps getting reelected, within every 5 years, he must call an election. But there's no term limits on how long he can be. Contrarily, this man, the President of the United States, Barack Obama, as you can see, with the American flag behind him, as most of all politicians use, does have term limits, 4 years. 8 years, the most he can be, the political power. So that's another difference between the Prime Minister and the President. I took these pictures. There's Congress, and there is Parliament. I've been to both of them now, so I just put them up there. So, versus the House of Commons. Differences, we'll get to that, between the U.S. and British government. Of course, I already said the 8-year term limit for presidents. And elections are held every 2 years on a set date, which, as we all know, is the second or the first Tuesday, rather, in November. In the UK, no term limit, as I said, for the prime minister. Until the day he dies, he can do that if you keep reelecting him. And elections over there have no set date. The prime minister can call for one anytime, which usually takes 4 weeks, 4 weeks to start. Until the election, in which they'll have one. And it must be within 5 years, although the prime minister usually has one every 4 years because it would be cowardly, they say, to wait 5 years with all your people. The main difference between the U.S. and U.K. politics is right there. The Constitution. We have a written set of laws that our forefathers drew up. In the UK, there is no written Constitution, and the politicians can change laws by a simple majority vote, which I found interesting, which shows how stable that their politics are, but they can do that because I can't imagine the Republicans and the Democrats doing that every week and changing the laws. I would never know what's going on. As it's written in black and white right there, and they still can't figure out anything. I just got a few pictures. That is Parliament when we were there. We took that picture. That's Parliament again. Union Jack is on top of it as we were walking through. And there's Big Ben, which I did not realize was connected to Parliament until I got there, as I just thought it was a big clock tower in the middle of nowhere. So it was interesting to see that. That is the end of that part. I do want to say once again, it was a privilege, and it was everything I knew and hoped it would be. You guys are great. I made a lot of friends, but I would take forever. And this opportunity was wonderful.
No, I'm afraid not. I have to see if I can find it. By the way, I'm Gabriel Bohari. My presentation, if I can ever find it, is supposed to be on the difference between the U.S. and the British political system. Not the political system, I'm sorry. I'm a little nervous today. Their education system. This is a comparison of the U.S. and U.K. educational systems. I'm just going to cover a couple points. My paper is extremely long, so... Okay, one of the major differences is that while the United States is run by the Department of Education, they set all the standards for diversity and what is considered the curriculum for the schools in the United States. However, in the United Kingdom, two different departments supersede certain things. For example, there is a regular Department of Education. It was actually just created in May of 2010. They constantly do this where they take the old system and then they make new ones out of those. Primarily, they deal with the, what we would call K through 12 education, although they have other names for it. We'll get to that in a minute. While the Department of Business, Innovation, and Skills focuses on more of the adult type educations, further education, which, not to be confused with how we define further education, which would be like Ivy Tech, etc., although it is similar in that it offers such as apprenticeships and certain skills, remedial skills that many of the businesses have to use, unfortunately, because of failing standards. But more on that later. Okay, as you can see right here, this is a, thank you Wikipedia, they had this little chart on there. And basically, despite the fact that you can see that they kind of make all their little yearly things. This is based off of August 1st. However, there's also ones who start in September. As you can see, they offer free education from age 3 all the way up to age 18. But it's mandatory from 5 to 16. Now, you'll see that they have different designations. For example, curriculum stage. This comes in handy because in stages 1, 2, and 3, they take certain standardized tests, mostly at a teacher assessment to see if they're actually learning the core curriculum as devised by the UK Department of Education. After that, they take the GCSE, which in essence determines what they're going, whether or not they're going on, into sixth form, or that take the A level. Little thing about the A levels is that unlike in our system where we have a core curriculum, in sixth form and in the universities, they do not have a core curriculum. So if you were taking mathematics, you would only learn mathematics. You would not deal with English or computer science. They ask that people take between 1 and 3 A levels. Many universities do not want to take anyone without that, with anything more than that, because A levels are so specific to a particular degree that if you're too well-rounded, you'll be rejected. If you can see, like for example, they have certain other designations such as either infant school, junior school, secondary school, or, and sometimes they call sixth form college. Maybe you remember Prince William, he went to Eton College. That was what he did for his preparation to St. Andrews in Scotland. They generally divide everything into primary school and secondary school, which is the most common designation. Just like how we divide certain levels. What doesn't show on this chart is actually many, year six really ends at 10 and a half, not 11. So that's a difference between our system and their system. They don't usually use middle school. It's starting to get into, I would say, vogue right now. There's a lot of influence from the American system. A lot of people in the newspaper, The Guardian, have a problem with that. Now this, of course, is the U.S. system, which honestly, I didn't realize how many different things that there are. I mean, I knew about middle schools and I knew about junior high, and I just didn't realize, and there were so many different little designations. This came from the Institute of Education Sciences, the U.S. Department of Education. It was posted on Wikipedia by James Hare. I've linked back to the original. But as you can see, little old Ivy Tech is right here. Here, the associate degree, if you can see, right there. I don't know if you can, but that's where Ivy Tech is in the big, huge scheme of U.S. schools. Now, comparing universities. Now, as you can see on the left, that's Ivy Tech Community College. That's our beloved campus, great campus. And on the right, this is Cambridge. This is King's College Cathedral. Now, despite the fact that you just learned from Jeremy that they don't have a lot of, they're very atheistic, consequently, many of their schools, higher education schools, were originally built around first Roman Catholic, then Episcopal seeds of education. Many, in fact, even today, the Episcopal Church and the Roman Catholic Church make up the majority of private-run schools in the United Kingdom. Now, just like in the United States, many of these schools receive federal funding. In fact, it's really, the major difference between them has to do with the fact that they have higher taxes, but they don't pay for anything. Okay. Now, one of the features of what is known as the Oxford system, which is the educational system of Oxford and Cambridge, is the tutorial system. Now, in recent years, there have been many changes. Originally, there was one gentleman right there who is a don at the one college, and he would have one student, he would meet with a student weekly. They would have multiple students, but they would meet one-on-one. However, as of 2010, because of the high levels of people trying to get in, they had to turn away approximately 100,000 people this year. They required them to now see anywhere from 5 to 10 students daily. Now, if you can notice this guy is a dunce. And that has to do with the fact that just like the United States has many problems, I'm sure you all read about how half of all college students after 2 years learns nothing. Well, they also have problems with that. Not people who are college students, but people who come out of their educational systems. In fact, there was a institute that did a study and they said that approximately 43% of the people that they hired could not read or write. Now, as we all know, that the United States has had a big issue with that. So it's quite interesting that having one of the oldest, most prestigious colleges in the world, that they would have this problem with their basic education system. Now, to get into this school, you know, you had to go through rigorous testing. I mean, for example, you had to pass the GCSE. You had to study for A levels. For example, Oxford and Cambridge both have AS, A, that is basically saying, it's like saying A plus A, in three subjects in order to be considered. Now, unlike the American system, they take into account the entire scope of the individual. So if an individual has special needs, or if the individual is strong in two areas but weak in one, and it's required to their major, but they can prove that they're able, then they can overlook that. Now, as you know, many of these colleges are, in the United States, however, are very, well, did you get A's? Did you get all A's? Did you go? There are people who get all A's, do all this extracurricular activity, and they still don't get in. The biggest issue at the universities, of course, is the fact there's not enough spots. So, they believe that in the next couple years, with the increase of fees, because unlike the American system, they have their education supplemented, so they're actually on a better off better after they get out of college from a economic standpoint. Although in next year their fees are going up to £9,000 per year, so that's $13,000-$14,000. So anyway, that's my presentation. Do you have any questions? Oh, no? Okay.
To Teresa. Okay, popular sports in the United States, of course, are baseball, football, basketball, soccer, and hockey, or several and several more. Your popular sports in England would be cricket, football, which is American soccer. We're like the only country that calls it soccer.
Wait, cricket is croquet.
No. You're gonna just simmer down. You have to learn. Okay, then they tennis. They're very famous with tennis, rugby, and polo. Okay. Are you ready? Teresa, you going to be okay?
I'm ready.
Just to let you know that, Teresa, football is soccer in England. Football in America is the only sport that America plays, that no other country plays, is football. So England's favorite pastime is football, even though their national, cricket is their national sport. Cricket, their objective is to make a score as many runs as possible. They have two teams, 11 players on each team, two umpires. There is, and it's really strange because their field is an oval or elliptical. It's not a square or a diamond. It doesn't have any certain dimensions. It just has to be big enough area to play. But in the middle of that, they have this thing called a pitch, which is a rectangular square where they start their playing the game. It's aligned. And they have two wickets and a bat on each end of the pitch. Okay, the cricket, you have a cricket ball, which is about the size and weight of a baseball, but it is different texture. You have a bat. Their bat is a flat bat on one side, and it is humped on the other thing to create strength. Then they have a bowler, which is basically a pitcher. And they have a striker and a non-striker. And different types of scoring. You can't just score. You can score like many ways on cricket, not just one. And there's types of outs too. Okay. Start with, this is your cricket gear. All right, and then the other one is the pitch on the side. If you see down on this side, on the bottom toward me, this guy here is the bowler, which is actually the pitcher. And then you have an umpire. And then you see that there is two guys holding bats. You have the striker on the far end, and the non-striker on this end, close to the bowler. The bowler runs up behind, he throws the ball, but he has to bounce the ball in front in order for the striker to hit it. Okay, if they hit it, then they run. And how they make their run is that the striker and non-striker, they run the opposite in and opposite back, and that would be one run. And that's how they score. And they can keep running until the ball is not in play no longer. And that's how they score. Then the wicket keeper is like your catcher on your baseball if that hits. The things that they're standing there, they're three stumps. They're really hard to see, I'm sorry. They're called wickets, they're three stumps, and they place two little bells on top. Wooden. If the ball knocks it off, then it is a strike or an out. Or if the player is blocking the area where the ball can't hit, like intentionally, and that makes them out. The bowler continues to pitch, and so six times. After six times, it is passed to another team member in the field. The batter continues to bat, or the striker, I'm sorry, until that person is out. These games last forever, days upon days, because if you don't get them out, they can continue to strike or bat until you get them out. Another way you can score is if you hit a fly ball and you hit it toward the boundary, out to the boundary, that's an automatic six runs. If you ground it and hit it to the boundary, that's an automatic four runs. Much more to it. I'm just giving basics. So basically, it's similar to baseball, which, you know, the objective of baseball is to get as many runs as possible. And you have two teams, but the teams are nine members instead of 11. And with baseball, you have a diamond shape, and you run bases, and you score home. And that's the only way you can get a run, is running your bases. And when you have a team, you can get three outs on a team, and not each person on your team. In baseball, they play nine innings. And in cricket, they have two innings. And they have the pitcher and batter. And there's their equipment and your diamond field. Much different than a cricket field and equipment. So in conclusion, the cricket is a very complex, more in-depth sport than what I could understand probably. Baseball is a branch of cricket and rounders. It came through that, even though it seems nothing like it. Both the scores of runs and they have outs. and cricket can last for days, and baseball is just a few hours of enjoyment. Thank you.
Still sounds like croquet.
Not croquet.
Do it the easy way. I'm going to stay over here and use my keyboard so I don't do all of this. But I'm Natalie Ellison, and I'm going to do a comparison. Well, first, I guess I'll beat a dead horse and tell everybody thank you, and I had a wonderful time, especially to the people who put this program together and made it possible for us to go for this once-in-a-lifetime experience, which we all had. Well, before we left, we did a trip up to Toyota in Princeton and did a tour of that. And then while we were in England, we got a chance to go to Birmingham and go to the Jaguar plant. So I'm gonna do a little comparison and history of the two plants for you guys. It all begins with these two men. We got Sakichi Toyota and William Lyons. We'll go into a little bit more about each of them. We'll start with Sakichi. In Japan, Sakichi, he was born in a poor family with, his dad was a carpenter, his mom was a weaver, and he was an ingenious little child, always trying to make things work better and fiddling with things, and he watched his mom weaving and was always trying to find a way to make it easier for him. Well, he grew up and he ended up going into the textile business and becoming a weaver himself. So he, I forget how many, he had invented several looms, always continually improving them until in 1924, he hit the jackpot with this Type G Toyota automatic loom. This revolutionized the textile industry. And, kind of, he got coined the Thomas Edison of Japan for this. And it ended up in 1929, he sold it to a British company for $150,000 back in those days, which is probably a pretty good sum of money. Along comes his son, Kichiro of Toyota. Well, he gets a lot of these same characteristics from his dad, and he's very inventive himself, an adventurous businessman. And they get all this money from the loom patent that his father had sold, and he gets really interested, especially in the West, in the automobile industry that's really starting to take off. So he starts researching on small gas-powered engines in about 1930. And by 36, he had completed his first car, the AA sedan. In 37, the Toyota Motor Corporation was formed. Now, we'll go back to England, where there's William Lyons. And he's a motorcyclist, and he'd kind of been to tech school and dropped out and was working, I think, at first as a salesman somewhere, and he runs into his buddy, William Walmsley, who is also a motorcycle enthusiast, and he is working at a shop where he is taking motorcycles that were left over from the war and recycling or refurbishing them for civilians and building these, he really liked, I think he was more of a crafter type than the business type, and he built these sidecars and was selling them to the public. Well, Lyons liked this idea, and he wanted to get in on the action, so, and he was a young man. They actually had to postpone starting their business till his 21st birthday, where he borrowed 500 pounds from his dad to get this business started. And it was actually on his 21st birthday that they did co-found the Swallow Sidecar Company in 1922. See the little, a picture of it better there. It later, like I said, I think from the research that I did, I think Wormsley was more of a crafty guy. He wasn't really interested in making this huge business that Lyons was. I think he was more of the entrepreneur of the bunch. And he decided that he liked the small business. He just wanted to get out of it. So Lyons bought him out. And in, let's see, it was 35. He bought him out and changed it to SS Cars Limited. It later, after the war, became Jaguar. One of the reasons I thought this was interesting that he changed the name was because, of course, the SS, he didn't want that confused with the Nazi SS of the time. And so the first Jaguar was actually, that was the name of the model of the car, was a Jaguar. And then after that, it took over the name of the company. And that was the first Jaguar. So now I just want to I found some old advertisement with some old cars, thought it was pretty neat. We'll go through a few of the advertisements of the early Toyotas. I thought it was kind of neat. Look at the price, $1,760 for your new Toyota. Was that the Corona there? Then I didn't even realize, I worked at Toyota for 11 years and I didn't remember the Toyopet crown, so that was something. And you can't see this other advertisement very well, but I thought it was interesting because that was one of the problems that Toyota had when they first started out, is building a car that had the power that the American people wanted. And so it says, the kind of car American families have been asking for. You can't see it very good on here, but I think it said that it gets up to 60 miles per hour, or maybe it was 50 miles per hour in like 20 seconds or something like that. They were really bragging on their speed there. Then we got some of the early Jaguar advertisements. And this Jaguar here, it actually was, I think this is the one that was called the 120, because at the time it was named after the speed that it reached, which was 120, the fastest car in the world at the time. So now we'll go back to Toyota in Princeton. It was built in 1996. The first vehicle to roll off the line was the Tundra, and that was in December of 1998. They employ about 4,000 people. They now, I just want to point out that in this bottom left picture, the guy in the little blue suit there, he's a friend of mine, Greg. I found that on the internet. These are the four vehicles that they have produced at the Princeton plant. They no longer produce the Tundra that's on the top left, but it was the first vehicle in 1999. Then came the Sequoia in 2001, which they do produce some of them still. Numbers aren't quite as high as they were. The Sienna came in 2003 and the Highlander in 2009. Base price on these start at $24,000 all the way up to $28,000. Or up to $40,000, rather, excuse me, and that's the base price. That's the bare bones model. But still, in comparison to the Jaguar, which we'll get to in a little bit, pretty economical. So this is the site that we visited when we went to Birmingham. It's Castle Bromwich, the factory there. We have to go back a little bit in history and talk about the history of the building. It's very interesting, and they're very proud of their history as well. The building was actually built in 1938, especially for the Royal Air Force to build Spitfire aircraft for them. And these pictures are really interesting. If you can see, I hope you can see clear up there, but the large picture of the tops of the building, they're actually camouflaged. Can you see that on the top? They're painted camouflaged. You can see the picture right to the side of it on part of the roof there. You can see where it's not all torn up there. That's the paint there to camouflage them. But that's pretty interesting.
This is
the plant now. And they're still proud of their heritage, as you can see. Look at this steel sculpture that's on the grounds there in the bottom left, that you can see the Spitfires taking off there. It's really interesting. I guess this is a light post on the side of the building here or whatever, but you can still see the wings and remnants of the past. Let's see, Jaguar took over that complete control of that plant in 1980, and it employs 3,500 people. I don't know if I said Toyota up here, they employ about 4,000. So they're pretty similar. They produce the three Jaguars. The XF is kind of their blended model. It's the midline between the luxury and the sports car. The XJ is the complete luxury car, which is the highest priced, as you can imagine. And the XK is the super sports car. Their starting prices are $50,000 up to $80,000. And like our tour guide there said, the sky's the limit on the, you can imagine some of the very wealthy, they really get their cars decked out. Now we'll talk about a little bit of the similarities. They are very similar companies, as most companies these days we know are going toward the lean manufacturing principles, and which originated with TPS with Japan. So I wanted to put this in here, people are key, and I got to point out a couple more people. The blue suit there with the left hand on the left side of it, that's my friend Matt. And the girl right there, this is something that Toyota did during the floods we had in the spring. They sent people out to deliver cleanup packages and stuff. And that's my sister there delivering those packages. But this is all about their people. And even though one of the differences, the main difference, was that Toyota is non-union. The Jaguar plant, oh, I forgot the most important thing. Jaguar, that's how they pronounce it in Britain, is Jaguar. And they think that we weren't it by saying Jaguar. It's not Jaguar. But the Jaguar plant is a union plant. Although all their principles are the same, and they follow the lean manufacturing of the Japanese, and they also, the people, let me give you, they have above average wages, excellent benefits, lots of extra benefits for their people, like flexible work schedules, job sharing, pensions, tuition reimbursements, car purchases. They have, I know Princeton up here doesn't have this, but other Toyota plants do. I thought it was really nice. They have a suggestion program at Jaguar that if you come up with a solution that saves the company money, you get 5% of what they save for the whole first year. Pretty good reward to try to problem solve, huh? I wanted to just go over a little bit. This is one of the main things that I noticed, that they follow They may call it a little different things, but they follow the Toyota production system pretty, almost exactly as Toyota does. And I just wanted to kind of go over a little bit about what that Toyota production system is. Probably a lot of you have already heard about it, but on the bottom you have the foundation, and the foundation of the TPS system is avoiding muda, is what Japanese call waste. And that's cost cutting by getting rid of your waste. And a lot of that waste can be in transporting, in extra movements, or extra people that you don't need. There's a lot of different waste that we don't really think about that can be cut out and that cost us money. On the outside pillars, I just want you to see that quality control embeds the whole structure of TPS. And that's one place where that's for everybody. The team members are the most important part of the industry. And they are expected to and required to try to improve their jobs. And that's what they do, and they build in quality at every stop. They don't want to wait until it's at the end of the assembly line, and then all of a sudden we see a problem that was 50 pitches back, and now we have a lot of repairs to do and costly muda, waste. So every team member is empowered and required to report those and get it taken care of in line and solve that problem right away. And the inside two pillars of the Toyota production system is the just-in-time system, which I know we probably all heard a lot about, and that's getting things to the right place in the right amount, only what's needed. And I know probably a lot of us have worked in places where they have big warehouses stocked full of supplies and lots of extra supplies on the floor or in the office or whatever. They have a Kanban system. I thought this was interesting, that the guy that came up with the Kanban, he actually came up with that idea from the grocery store. He was shopping one day and he noticed, he picked the last item up off the shelf. Well, there's this card behind it, order new supplies. And so he thought, hey, that's what we need to do in our factory. So that's kind of how the Kanban system works. They only put so much out, and it's not only factories, it works everywhere. Office supplies, anywhere. You get what you need for a certain amount of time, and you don't order more until they're needed. The Jidoka, it's automation is what it stands for, but it's also automation with a human touch. The people are very important, and they know that, you know, machines and robots and technology, all that is great, but without the human touch behind it, it's not worth as much. We need our human brains searching out the problems. So I think that is why we have two companies that are prestigious, win lots of awards, are very well respected, and we'll probably see a lot more great things from these two companies. And this was us when we visited the Jaguar plant with our little smocks on. We had a lot of fun.
We got to go,
they had a nice visitor center, and we got to go and sit in a convertible Jaguar, and it was really nice for a moment to dream. Any questions? Okay.
Thank you very much, everyone.
Hi, I'm Mary McCutcheon. I used to work at...
Oh, I'm sorry, can you hear me now? I don't have to stress my voice to it. I was very privileged to work at University of Evansville for 2 years, and I thought the best program they had was for their students to be able to travel to Harlaxton and spend a semester. I walked into Ivy Tech, and I was told, oh, the business group is going to Harlaxton this year. Maybe you can go. So my dream did come true after many years, but I was very privileged, made new friends, and it's a great experience, a lot of history over there. I'm doing cathedrals. We're doing Lincoln Cathedral in Lincolnshire, England, compared to St. Patrick's Cathedral in New York City. I've actually been to both of them. I was in New York City 6 weeks before it was literally bombed. So a few others in this room has also have some very sentimental feelings about that, but we're glad we did see the Twin Tires in their entirety. This is the Lincoln Cathedral, and as you see, there is the University of Lincoln students there that are using it as for their graduating class. I want you to, so it's a up-to-date cathedral. It is used for a lot of things. Notice the skyline. I just want you to notice the skyline. This area of England was never industrialized, so you don't see a whole lot of buildings back behind there. Sandy, I don't see my little writing on here. This is St. Patrick's Cathedral in 1913. This building is actually made of brick, but it is overlaid with white marble. It has the brick undersurface because of the largeness of this cathedral, and it was very heavy for the towers, so it had to have a lot of strength. This is also notice the skyline, how open it is. This is the before and after picture of 911. In the right-hand corner, if you look up at the skyline, you will see the Twin Towers behind it. The most recent pictures, they don't exist anymore. I'll be going back and forth a little bit to show comparison, but I've tried to avoid that as to avoid confusion. This is the original, the one with the red roof, is the original 1072 Lincoln Cathedral. The towers, as you can see in the upper right-hand corner, or left-hand corner, were added throughout history at different times. On two of the towers are two men, one St. Hugh and one is a poor man. We'll come back to him in a minute. These are the three towers of Lincoln. At one time, the middle tower was 571 feet, but it is 271 feet today. Too heavy, it collapsed at some point in history. This is the layout of Lincoln. If you see the little round spigots coming out, that is the chapter house. And up by the chapter house is the east end. Now you have to think of Christ on the cross, his arms outstretched. The head is always the east altar. The arms are the transepts. And the bottom half is the nave, considered the west. Always. This is the way all cathedrals are set up. The high altar is always in the east, and they start building at the east. Now, this is the cathedral in St. Patrick's, and you can barely see little bitty transepts, not very many, on the inside, but when we see the outside, you'll see a bigger, you'll be able to see the cross. Now, here is the chapter house to your right, and this is the east window from the outside, the stained glass. This is just a little bit closer look. At the very top of that pinnacle was the Blessed Virgin and Child. You see the crockets, they're called crockets. The little round things. And they're metal, and they're covered with lead. And our when we went to Grantham to a cathedral, our tour guide said he thinks there was a lot of lead in their water, and many people probably got sick, although they really didn't realize it at the time. This is the great east window that we had just seen with the chapter house, the beautiful stained glass. Most of the stained glass is 13th and 14th century. This is the chapter house in the round building. This is the Pope's seat. It's a very old one. I do not know if it's the original one. I really doubt it because Lincoln was burned and had an earthquake, so most things were destroyed. But this is a very early dated bishop's seat. To be a cathedral, the bishop's seat has to be in that church. If the bishop didn't have his seat there at Lincoln, it would not be the cathedral. Also customary in Britain is the Lincoln City would not be a city unless it was the bishop's seat. It doesn't matter how big the city, the town is, it has to have the bishop's seat to be a city. This is the nave, the west part. You can see the great east window in the background. The nave is very large. I want you to notice the ceiling. I want you to notice, if you can look through the arched doorway, you see a white doorway behind there, kind of, little white arches. That is the beginning of the Angel Choir, Hugh's Angel Choir. This is the wall between the nave and the Angel Choir. It's very detailed. A lot of work went into that. And back when it was first built, 1072, 1092, it was painted very brightly colors. This is the Angel Choir. Now, those seats date back to 14th century. They're still used today and very well worn. They don't have kneelers. They would have like a pillow that you put on the floor to kneel on. And the books that they used to say their daily prayers were extremely worn. The high altar is up there. And if you noticed at the wedding at Will and Kate, there was choir. And then the people were sitting way far away, and that is true. I just never understood why the people had to sit so far away, but it's the way everything is set up, the way things are done over there. That is a little imp behind the Angel Choir. My mama used to say, "You little imp." So maybe she had some heritage there, I don't know. this is just an outline, and what I really want you to notice in some of these pictures that you'll be seeing is how the light came in way up high, right under the arches of the very high. It's called a clear story. And that is where your upper level of windows were, and that let in, it just flooded light in. Remember, there was no electricity back then. So if you can see in this picture, you can see how light it is up at the top. That's your light coming in from the windows up at the clear story. This is the nave. Now we would be sitting at the high, we would be sitting at the high altar looking to that door. The door that the people are standing in front of is the door to the west. We're going to get to those in a few minutes. This is a baptismal. When they talked about a steep hill earlier, this is for marble. It is marble. It was brought in from Europe. And Lincoln Town itself sits on a huge steep hill. And they had to drag that up that hill to get it into the church. And it came in parts, solid marble. I'm going to show you just a little bit more detail of that. And if you notice in the background, you on the left side is a Roman door. It's rounded, arched, the Romanesque style. You can see it better here. It's a very good comparison. The Rome arched, rounded on the left, and the Gothic style on the right. That is the west end. This is just some detailed pillars. This is the, they call it the high vault, the ceiling. And that is your more detailed work. This is the west front door. We're going to talk about that row of, I'm going to show you a closer version of the row of sculptured people in the front. I wish I had a pointer. I know the other ones did too. And also the stonework that is around the front door. That is the front door stonework. And you can see, if you look real close, there are some sculptures carved inside. And these are kings. That was above the door. And this is the poor man who gave all he had. And Bishop Hugh said this was more than anybody could have ever given. So this man is up in the pinnacle with Saint Hugh. A pence. He gave a pence, or sixpence. Sixpence was not very much. So William the Conqueror conquered in 1066, 1072. Regimius was given money and land to start the building of the Lincoln Cathedral. This is, I don't know if you can see the gargoyle that is, it's like a gutter. Rain falls in there and it just, it turns into a fountain. It's a drain spout, so the water is sometimes 2 or 3 feet away from the building, which keeps the which is really good. I'm amazed at some of the things they had to protect your foundation. This is a better view of a gargoyle. Not all of them are drain spouts. Some of them are just decorations. This is the Dean's Eye. Has been restored, fully restored in 2006. Worked on it for 16 years. This is a closer view of it. This is the medieval glass, original, 19. Well, they told us that the real original medieval glass, and you're talking 1050, is much darker than the more modern glass. You could, if you see them side by side, you would be able to tell the difference. This is the dean's, the bishop's eye. And if you notice, you have leaves, 2 leaves. I hope you can see that. And that is overlooking the bishop's residences back in the time it was built. And this is the inside of it. Now we're at St. Patrick's. This is the present Archbishop welcoming you to St. Patrick's. This is St. Patrick, who the church is named after. And you can see that it is used. This is a St. Patrick story in the top one. This is St. Patrick in stone. This is their rose window. and they have weddings, and they want you, St. Patrick's like you, to write in and tell you about your story. This is the nave. This is at Christmas time. This picture was from 1987. If you notice, they have pews instead of chairs. This is a more updated version. This is the sanctuary at St. Patrick's. And this is one of the little chapels with the Virgin Mary. I think the stained glass is phenomenal, and the architecture. Can you see in the background of the middle window how the pillars go up and they stretch out? And our guide at the King's College told us that the Gothic just makes you reach up and feel lifted up. This is Lady of Guadalupe Chapel. They bury their dead bishops there and other important people in St. Patrick's and region. St. Hugh, who rebuilt the cathedral in Lincoln, was buried in Lincoln, and he was a major. When people made pilgrimages there and prayed at his tomb, they would bring in a lot of wealth. So Lincoln was very wealthy at one time, but when the Reformation happened, the body of St. Hugh was taken out, and the money did not filter in anymore. This is St. Patrick's in New York City, taken from the Rockefeller Center. This is their baptismal. Now you can see the cross of this St. Patrick's picture very plainly, and that's taken from the Rockefeller Center too. And this view, if you can see the big front doors there, we're going to talk about the front doors and the big high rose window in a few minutes. And this, if you can see in the foreground, is the it's a sculpture in front of the Rockefeller Center, so you can kind of see where all those pictures have been taken. And that is the rose, and then that is their stained glass. Now, I did find out that the person who designed their stained glass was from Birmingham, England. I was just astonished. This is their front door, very carved, and that's just a little bit different, different specs on it there. And that is all. Thank you very much.
My name is Monica Flieger, and I want to thank you all for being here. This was my first visit to England, and it was really a lifetime experience, had a lot of fun, and I want to thank Ivy Tech for having this study abroad program available to all of us. Today I'm going to be comparing Harlaxton Manor and the Biltmore House, and I have been fortunate enough to visit both of these estates, and they are bigger and more magnificent in person than they are just by these pictures, and they actually have to be seen to be believed. I did visit Harlaxton in June 2011, and when we first arrived, The first thing I could think about was, wow, this really looks like the Biltmore, which I visited in July 2009. I'm going to be going over the general overview of the estates, the architecture styles, who the estate owners were, interior rooms, and then also the exterior and the gardens, and then the estates today. This is a picture of Harlaxton. It is a 100-room mansion, and it's surrounded by 117 acres. It is located in Grantham, England, and that is about 2 hours away from London. It was built in the 1830s for Gregory Gregory, and that is really his name. The first section of the manor was completed in 1837, and he resided in Harlaxton, and the manor was completed in 1855. Unfortunately, he could only reside there for a few years before his death in 1854. And then this is a picture of the Biltmore House. It is a 250-room house, and it has 8,000 acres. It's always been a family-owned residence, and it is managed and by the family still, and it is the largest private-owned residence in America. It's located in Asheville, North Carolina, and it was built in 1889 for George Vanderbilt, and the Vanderbilt family is very well-renowned and respected. The house was built by 1,000 workers over a 6-year period, and it officially opened on Christmas Eve in 1895. It was considered one of the most technologically advanced structures ever built because it did have full electric and central heat included in it. After it was built, 3 years later, he brought his wife, her name was Edith Dresser, to the house, and then they had one child, her name was Cornelia, and she was born at the Biltmore House. The architecture style of Harlaxton, it's combined Gothic, Jacobean, and Baroque style architecture. And the Jacobean and Baroque, that just means bold ornamentation, sense of drama, and extravagant. It's made of Ancaster stone, and that was found in Lincolnshire, England. And then this was Gregory's English country home, and he traveled throughout England and Europe seeking inspiration and ideas for his house. And then the Biltmore House, Vanderbilt wanted a richly ornamental French Renaissance mountain home, and he chose North Carolina for its mild temperature and then also the scenery there. He really fell in love when he went to visit North Carolina with his mom. And during a visit in the mid-1880s, he purchased 125,000 acres in the Blue Ridge Mountains for this estate. And it is made of Indiana limestone, which was brought from 600 miles away. Gregory was a wealthy man who built the Harlaxton. He didn't have any family, so he devoted all of his energies and most of his life to building the house, and that was his only extravagance. He never seemed to have entertained, and everything was prepared for a group of servants, children, and guests. He did have a love of art and beauty, and he traveled throughout Europe collecting ideas for his house. Sadly, there's very little information on Gregory, and his personal papers are currently lost. This only image of Gregory comes from the one roundels at the top of the cedar staircase in the house. So this is the only picture that they do have of him. George Vanderbilt, on the other hand, the house is still in the family, so there's a lot of information about George Vanderbilt, but his life mission was to build Biltmore, and he spared no expense with it at all. His family had a vast fortune in shipping and railroads, and it was designed as a country retreat for Vanderbilt, his family and friends, and then also so he could pursue his passion for art and antiques, and he also loved literature and horticulture. He took special pride in entertaining many guests at Biltmore, and that included famous and worldly individuals also to his neighboring children and friends. These pictures are some of the rooms in Harlaxton, the Great Hall, the Gold Room, and Cedar Staircase. The Great Hall, that included the crystal chandelier, which was the largest of its time, and that room is notable for its oak paneling, which you can see in the picture. The Gold Room in the middle, that's decorated, has large mirrors on either side, but then you can also, at the top, you can see all of the cherubs, and they were painted on the cloud swirled ceiling, and if you can see in the picture, they're trying to unscrew that chandelier. The Cedar Staircase, I think that was one of Harlaxton's greatest attractions. The ceiling is made of stucco, and then the floor in that room is made of marble. And it was a really pretty room. That was one of my favorite rooms. The Biltmore interior, unfortunately, when I took the tour, you can't take any pictures inside, so I don't have any pictures. This picture of the Winter Garden, that's as soon as you walk in, and that's just the interior garden, which was popular during that age. The house does have 43 bathrooms, 65 fireplaces, 3 kitchens, 34 bedrooms, and then a grand banquet hall and a library. The 43 bathrooms in 1895 was a rarity because many homes at that time didn't even have a single indoor bathroom, and he had 43. And his favorite, Vanderbilt's favorite room was the library because he began collecting books at age 11. And so that's why that library contains so many volumes of books. And then the basement, that was set up for fun and recreation, had a 19th century gymnasium, an 8.5-foot deep swimming pool, and then a bowling alley, which was considered the oldest of the nation. And that also included the servants' quarters and the kitchens. These are some of the pictures of the Harlaxton grounds and garden. The garden included French-style terraces, an Italian garden, a Dutch ornamental canal, conservatory, and an English landscape walk. The 6.5-acre walled garden is one of the largest in Britain. The conservatory was a later addition to the house, and that's one of the largest conservatories of its kind. And then they also had a pair of the marble lions that you can see in the picture on the bottom, and they can be seen flanking the fountain in the top of the gate piers of the front circle at Harlaxton. And these are pictures of Biltmore. Their gardens include a walled garden, an azalea garden, an Italian garden, which also had the reflecting pool, and then they also had a glass conservatory. The walled garden enclosed 4 acres of flowers and a rose garden, and the conservatory contained a collection of palms and ferns and other exotic plants. Guarding the main entrance at Biltmore are also massive carved lions also. They had those too. Harlaxton today, it did become Harlaxton College in 1965. And then each academic year, 300 students have the privilege of living and studying abroad. And then they also host summer school, short courses, concerts, weddings, and different other events at the college. And then Biltmore today, it was designated a National Historic Landmark. It is owned by the Biltmore Company, which is controlled by Vanderbilt's grandson. Because after Vanderbilt's death in 1814, his wife continued to manage the estate, and their daughter Cornelia married John Cecil and had 2 sons. And so the Cecil family opened Biltmore House to the public, hoping to increase tourism during the Depression. And Biltmore is still family owned, and like I said, George Vanderbilt's grandson continues on the traditions and wishes of his father and his great-grandfather. And in addition to the house, the estate operates 4 restaurants, and then they also have 8 shops, a winery, and there's a 213 room inn on the estate as well. When I was there, I was fortunate enough to go to the gardens and then also stop by the winery and also went to the inn. These are the Harlaxton College website and also the Biltmore website where you can find more information. There are some actual pictures on the Biltmore website, of the actual rooms, but like I said, that you can take pictures when you were there. Does anyone have any questions? Okay, thank you.
Hi, my name is Katina Maffitt, and I had the honor of joining all these guys over in England, which we had such a wonderful time. It was quite an experience, and I wish everyone could get a chance to go over there. It was really nice. Out of all the places that we went to, I found the Roman baths. Romans. I found the Roman baths the most exciting out of all the places that we visit. I thought it was a good comparison to today's day spas. That's what it pretty much reminded me of, because it was a place where they went and they socialized, they got massages, there were gymnasiums available. You wouldn't think that there was gyms back in those days, but there were, and the history dates all the way back to like 60 to 70 AD. So I thought that that was very exciting to know that I was standing on those grounds. This is a picture of a slave that she is standing in front of one of the temples with a bird on her head. And if you see my two friends, oh, they're kind of off to the side as Natalie's back to us. But I happened to come out and I caught the end of it, and our tour guide, what was he showing you guys, where the fountain, like, it did something.
They burned up the water of the body.
Okay, I seen you guys doing something with this stone. I caught the end of it, but I thought this was a really nice statue of a slave that stood in front of the temple. This is just a statue of one of the Roman Greeks. He is standing above the bath, like on the outside where you walk around, and I just thought it was a really nice statue. This is another statue. This is a picture, you can see the temple, because there's like four places. They're all connected. It was the Roman bath, the Roman temple. I can't think of number two. Some more of the Roman Greeks. These were two ladies that were sitting next to the bath that were dressed up like the Roman women. Thought that was really nice with the old-timey wigs on. Yeah, that's my buddy. That's Southern British, right? Canadian British. There you go. Yeah, he was Canadian British while we were over in Europe. So, yeah, I got a good picture of him standing next to one of the Greek gods. This is a piece of the bath dating back to 76 AD. I don't know, I just thought it was an interesting piece. So this is a piece of the bath before, I guess by the time they got this part, the bath was already built. It's a small monument, dates back to 76 AD. So I thought that was really neat. They reconstructed the Roman bath. I thought this was really pretty with the blue waters streaming all through. This was sitting like on a desk when we first walked in, and it was just a reconstruction of the bath, and I thought that was really neat and beautiful. Plus, blue is my favorite color, so it really caught my eye. This is another reconstruction of the Roman baths. This was another table that they had with this sitting on top of it. And I remember the tour guide told us when we first got there that back then the Romans really liked the color white, and all the houses were stone white. And of course now today when you look at those, you can tell that they used to be pretty. They're still pretty, but they were, you know, they lost their color a little bit due to everything else going on in the world, I guess. These are pictures inside of that reconstruction. You see the women standing over here. I guess you would say that they were in there, I don't know, I guess having girl talk at the spa. This is another place inside of there that I found very interesting. I don't have no idea what it is, but it's inside there, so it's part of the Roman bath. I guess these would be considered, I don't know how to get back to that. The Roman bath was like a public place for the Romans to come and bathe in. A lot of the homes didn't have bathrooms, so this is the place that they used. And as you see, like the little man down in the bath, there's one sitting over to the side, and the Roman Greeks standing back here a little bit. Everyone used the same bath, the men and the women. Of course, not at the same time. The men got a little extra time, more than the women. Children were not allowed there, so it was just a place for adults. I would say this would be a reconstruction of the front of the temple that they had reconstructed inside of there. And you see the Romans coming to the bathhouse, and I know the child's not going there, so I don't know. Again, the women, I guess this is the table that they lied on to get their massages, and I have no idea what she's doing back there, but maybe she's getting her exercise on. I don't know.
Now, the lady in that bench in the middle-ish.
Right here?
No, forward. Yeah, she naked.
And this is a picture of the bath today. This is what it looks like today. As you see, some of the stones still have a little color of the white to it. The rest of it is a little smoked. It's another part of the bath. Another place that they visit was the Scarlet Spring. Sacred Spring, I'm sorry. Yeah, something like that. I thought this was really neat. I think I took this picture with the flash off and it made it look like it was a hot spring because that's what came out of there, the hot water. So I thought that was really neat. I wanted to show you guys that. This is a reconstruction of a head. I'm about to show you the actual reconstruction, but this information was like in front of it, you know, to give you a little background on this man that's laying here. Him. This is the reconstructed head, and as you see, the skeleton body. This was inside the museum there. That was another place that was connected. A museum, yeah. I wish I would have put some more stuff of the museum on here, because there was a lot of neat things in there, like their combs and hairpins and stuff like that, and I had took pictures of them, but I don't know why I didn't put them in here. I guess I didn't think about the museum that much, but this was the museum that was connected that we walked through, and I thought that was really neat to see a live skeleton land inside this glass. There's, you know, the full body, you can see it from there. That was really neat. Now we will enter the temple courtyard. I thought this was really neat too, because it's just amazing that this stuff still exists. This is like below the ground level, and I'm assuming that this is part of the city, but I just thought it was really neat that it was still there, and you know, I just wanted to share with you guys. Here's more parts of it. There's underground, I guess, leading to the bath, because I forgot to tell you guys that the bath is below street level. So it sits down pretty low. And these are parts of the Roman bathhouse that's still there. That went too fast, okay. This is their spring that a lot of people came there and they threw money. Well, as you see the sparkling stuff in there, that's money. I would think it was a wishing well, but after doing my research, the people came there and they threw things in there because they believed that these waters had healing powers. And they believed that, so they came and they drank the water, and of course, you can't drink it now, but we couldn't even get in it, but you know. I just thought that was really neat, and I have another picture. I have one with flash and one without the flash, so I thought they were like two differently neat pictures. And that's the one without the flash, and I just thought that was really pretty. And again, as you see the sparkling at the bottom, that's where people, I even made a wish. I'm sure other students came through there and made wishes too. Don't know if it's gonna come true, but I, you know, took a chance. Yeah, I just wanted y'all to know that I was there. This is a picture of today's spas. Thought this kind of reminded me of the Roman bath because of aromatherapy. You know how you can go to the spas and have the heated rocks laid on your back. Thought that was really neat. A neat picture of the spas today. A massage, right? Everyone likes massages. So, again, just reminding me of the Roman baths, you know. The spas today are still for men and women, so, except this time, you know, the men don't get to spend more time than we do. It's equal now, which is great. So it's just, I just found a lot of neat pictures of today's spas, and I just want to share them with you. Again, we use spas today to go and socialize and hang out and catch up on business matters and, you know, just entertainment with friends. You can still exercise at the spas, as you see that they're doing here. Couples can go together, relax, have a nice time together, as they're doing here. Wouldn't it be nice to just be able to just get in the water and lay on the bench and watch the sunrise or something? I just thought that was a really neat picture. Also a beautiful picture of today's spas with the, I would think it would remind me of the Roman baths because, I don't know, the spa in the middle of the floor, I would think that would remind me of the Roman baths. This is also a beautiful picture. I forgot to include that when they started building the Roman baths, it took them over 300 years to complete it. I would think that our generation is quite spoiled. 300 years to complete building something, and today it takes, less than 30 days to build something? I mean, I could only imagine carrying those stones from wherever they came from just to build that. Generations after generations, 300 years, that's a long time. And that concludes my story. So, does anyone have any questions?
So, what's that image there?
Could
you hover over?
Yeah. It's not making any sound.
Let's see. What is it?
Oh, I added sound effects.
Oh, okay.
Thank you.
That was our last presentation. Does anybody have any questions about the trip? Anything else that we visited that you didn't see here, maybe you saw it on blog?
Stonehenge,
yeah. It was very windy, wasn't it? Yeah.
And we were there
for
the day of summer solstice.
The summer solstice was the day that we were at Stonehenge, which was interesting. But we got there later, not with the crowds, you know, watching the sunrise, which didn't happen because it was cloudy, so they didn't get to see what they came for. Anybody else? Well, thank you all for coming.
Yes,
we appreciate
you.
Your attendance tonight and helping the students share their experiences. And thank you.